Okay, so hello to everyone. This is Friday, January the 3rd of 2020, and this is my first question and answer video of the new year. So I hope you all are coming out of your vacations great. This is going to be the normal frequently asked questions responses. This is the way to be. And this is episode 45. So even though this is live, I'm still going to start off by answering the questions that were submitted during the week. And the first one is from Pibley, says, I like your chicken videos. Why don't you have chicken-based t-shirts in your Teespring? My Teespring list is down below. Haven't done chickens before. Be happy to do it, though. So those will be coming up in the new year. So here comes the first bee-related question. This is from Mitch Flanagan. How often do the flow hives have to be cleaned out in comparison to the normal setup? So the flow hive mechanisms are complicated, and how often do I clean them? I pull them off every end of the season. So September, October, after that final nectar flow, I remove the flow supers and take them out to a robbing station. The bees clean them up, and then they go into storage where they are now. So they're all stacked. So how often do I clean the flow hive flow supers? Once a year through the winter. And then one of the advantages to taking off your flow supers during the winter time, you get to see which of your colonies in spring are doing the best and are the strongest, and those that build up fastest. We get your flow supers, return to those, and then you're pretty well guaranteed a good honey collection from those flow supers when you put them on strong colonies. So we do it once a year. That question was from Mitch. And for those of you who are just checking in now, we're doing a regular question and answer video like I do normally on Fridays, even though it's live. I'm going to kind of ignore the comment stream until I get to the end of the questions that were submitted during the week. So this comes from Nancy Knowlton. Can you explain how a new beekeeper will know when the nectar flow has begun and how to go about manipulating a colony in preparation for the nectar flow? So now this leads me to one of the really great aspects of keeping bees in your backyard. You're going to be paying closer attention to the environment other than the weather. So when spring kicks in, you can learn what's going on with your bees by looking at the landing boards. And that seems obvious, but the more time you spend staring at your landing boards and seeing what your bees are behaving like, the more you'll realize they're going through a natural annual rhythm that's based on the seasons. So the first thing you see in the beginning of the year that may be the start of a nectar flow really isn't a heavy nectar flow, but more of a pollen provision. So the bees are going to get a lot of their pollen from trees primarily early in the year where I live. And you'll start to see the pollen coming in, and that means they're going to start raising brood. Shortly after that, when the temperatures rise, the nectar will also start to kick in. So you can walk around your property in areas, wild areas, maybe near where you live. Go and see what the honeybees are working on, and that will show you when they start to really work those flowers, they'll be bringing in more nectar, and that's referred to as a nectar flow. Some people call it interchangeably a honey flow. So the other thing is, what's going on at the landing board? You should see a lot of activity. Now, I do a lot of slow motion video sequences of bees, even at landing boards, because it's fun to watch. When a bee comes in and they're really loaded with resources, pollen doesn't really weigh them down. The nectar does. So when those pollen-loaded bees are coming in and they're really heavy and they're barely making it to the landing board, you are in a nectar flow. So now some of these nectar flows last for a very long time. Some of the ways that some of the newer high-tech beekeepers are learning if their bees are, if their hives are taking on weight and if the colony is bringing in nectar, they use the hive scales. Broodminder is one of them. And there also are mechanical hive scales that will show that these scales start taking on, the hive starts taking on weight as all of that nectar comes in and they start loading in those resources. So that's one way that you can tell when the nectar flow is on. So the next part of this question, again, is what do you do in preparation for that? Well, as you've come through winter, hopefully your boxes are condensed down. So now when the nectar flow comes on and you see those resources filling up, that's when you want to start adding medium supers to your colony. So let's say you have a 10-frame box or an 8-frame box, If 6 out of 8 are full of resources, or 8 out of 10 are full of resources, that's time to go ahead and add on another box, so that when the nectar flow really kicks in, they can start to fill those up. So that's how you tell. It's direct observation. And likewise, all this activity, all the bees rushing in and out, going in and bringing in those resources, there's a lot of activity on the landing board. You will see those activities decline when you're in a dearth. So that's when you have a lot of unemployed foragers just sitting around. So then you would say you're not in a nectar flow then. So it's through direct observation of your bees. One of the funnest things to do when you keep bees is to see what's going on in the landing boards. So they're raising brood when they're bringing in pollen. They're bringing on nectar. Their bodies are nicely extended. Their abdomens are full, and they're flying in heavy. So they're landing hard. Sometimes they bump into each other and they fall right to the ground in front of the hive. There's a nectar flow on. So observe your environment too, see what they're going after. Next one is from Peter Melanson. Why so many people say avoid this flow hive? Is there any way I can visit you? I'm a new beekeeper. Okay, well, most of the people that are saying to avoid flow hives, and this comes up so often, is because early on when the flow hive invention was first announced to everyone, a lot of people that were experienced in keeping bees just looked at the mechanism and said, it's going to kill bees, it's not going to work, it's got plastic in it. There were any number of reasons that they put out for why it would not work and why they're against it, and people are against it today. So there's nothing you can do about that. And you know what I say? Don't worry about it. You will end up selecting the type of hive that you want to use, and you'll also have honey supers on, whether they're flow supers or traditional Langstroth medium boxes, whether they're naturally drawn comb, whether they're solid foundation, wax foundation, plastic foundation. There are so many different options, and what happens is for the backyard beekeeper, you will arrive at whatever system and setup you personally want to work with. So over the last, since 2016, we've been gradually adding more and more flow mechanisms to my backyard apiary. And they're working out extremely well. So a lot of the early concerns that the experienced, beekeepers, I was one of the experienced beekeepers too, but I did not want to make a judgment about flow hives until I had it in hand and had direct observation on how they worked. And what happened was they actually did work. And they continue to work. So those who think that you're going to chop up your bees when you activate it, that's proven not to be true. Those that thought that once the mechanism was activated and the surface wax stayed unchanged, that the bees wouldn't know that the honey was gone and then they'd think there was honey and there wasn't any, that's not true. The bees know right away as soon as the honey is gone. So all of these arguments have faded away gradually, but some people still stand with crossed arms, refusing to even discuss it. I find that when people don't want to discuss an issue at all, then they're not standing on very good logic, really. You should be willing to discuss anything. My mind is open on many subjects. Even though I've adopted a method, that doesn't mean that I've shut my mind to every other method that somebody else may have. And that's the way you should approach beekeeping, because you're going to hit, encounter people in beekeeping that are going to have solid opinions about every part of beekeeping, and they're non-negotiable. So, well, that's up to you. Maybe you like the way they keep those bees, and maybe you like the way they configure their hives. Like me, I'm always looking at new things and considering it. Now, if that doesn't seem like a great idea to me, I just don't use it. There's no reason to build walls around yourself. Knowledge is an exchange. A lot of people that hear, you're down here in the comments section now, right, here, and you're friends with each other. So everyone that watches my videos does not agree with the way I approach beekeeping at every level. So I am open to discussion, always. But so many people say avoid this flow hive. I would say mostly because they haven't used it. Yeah, or they did and didn't have a great experience with it right out of the bat. The number one complaint is cost. So the early arguments about what would not work have proven not to be founded in real-time experience. So there's that. Next question, number 5, comes from Panther Man. When spring gets here and the dandelions start, what do people do about cutting their lawns? Am I the only one that struggles with this idea? Where I live, I kind of turn it into a joke. Every spring on Facebook, I always put out my Save the Dandelion campaign. I encourage people to stop their neighbors from using herbicides on their yard. You have really been sold a bill of goods when it comes to being told, if you live in suburbia, that your green lawn needs to be green with grass only and nothing else. In other words, if it flowers, it should be killed if it's wild. Now that has been perpetuated by chemical companies that are selling you a bill of goods, really, when it comes to how you should treat your lawn. So I know this isn't the question, but this is my pet peeve every year. All the chemical companies come around and put flyers on people's doors. They all want to do chemical treatments on your yard. If you have any clover in your yard, if you have dandelions in your yard, any of these weeds, which by the way are very benign, you can run across your yard barefoot, step all over clover and step all over the dandelions and not hurt yourself. 100% of the dandelion is edible, flower stems, leaves, roots. So I can see why they want to get rid of it, you know, and I'm being completely sarcastic on that. So the other thing is we want to discourage people from using pesticides, what I call the hug and the slap. That is weed and feed. So they're killing the weeds and they're hugging the yard. So they're feeding it and killing. If it has side on it, herbicide, pesticide, that means it's designed to kill something, I wouldn't use it on my yard. So then the other part is, and to answer Panther Man, you're not the only one that feels this way. I love it when I go, for example, my youngest sister is an attorney. She lives in a big city that I won't name. But when you go into her yard, I look at their yard and it's full of wildflowers. Like they don't mow their yard. So their grass is 6 inches tall, 8 inches tall. And their neighbors' yards are groomed like golf courses. So they're not liked by their neighbors, but they're affected by the idea that this is now a living green space under their control that provides for insects, pollinators. And so when your yard is alive, I have another thing that I do. It's called stomping the yard. So, and it has nothing to do with the movie. After a rain, when the yard is soft, walk out into your own yard and stomp the soil and you'll hear the yard percolate right away. That's all the worms retracting and going through their little holes and everything. So when you stomp a damp yard, you'll hear all the activity in the yard, all the worms are moving. And to me, that's a sign of a healthy yard. And then I can go at my sister's neighborhood. I can go to the neighbor's house. I can go in their yard after rain. I can stomp on it. And guess what you hear? Nothing. So even the worms, all this important biomass and all these living organisms are destroyed. So I don't trust it. So once again, here's the other part, the mowing. Here's what I hate. Now, I have acres of land. I don't like mowing. I'm anti-mowing, but I have to mow. So the other thing is, if you mow in the afternoon when the grass is dry and you feel like that's the best time to mow your yard, that's when your bees are out on the clover and on the dandelions. So you're mowing over bees. They don't get enough. So if you could change even your mowing habits, not just first of all, let all of your little lawn, you know, flowers get to a decent height so they can flower. Dandelions flower at a pretty short height, and so do the white clover. So if you're mowing at 4 inches, 3.5 inches, you're just going to chop off the heads of them, and then there are going to be some flowers still left. So the other thing is, when you let your lawn, if somebody says, why is your lawn growing so long? Why do you let your grass go like that? Well, provides for deeper roots. Deeper roots mean a more drought-resistant lawn and a healthier lawn. So you can stand toe-to-toe and create a logical argument for the person who's going to challenge you on your mowing taller or letting your dandelions and your dandelions and clover primarily, let them get tall enough so the bees can use them. So mow in the evening or early morning so you're not mowing the bees, and let your lawns grow taller. You have far more arguments in favor of a taller, diverse lawn. Let the clover grow, let your dandelions grow, And don't let anybody tell you different. So Panther Man, when spring gets here, I invite you all to join in a campaign for keeping people from chemically treating their yards, because it's a lie. You can't tell me that children like to play in a yard more because it's just green as compared to having little weeds that benefit the environment in there. The other thing is, guess what? Your lawnmower cuts weeds easier than it cuts grass. It's true. So you're actually saving energy. You're saving power. You're saving fuel. So you're not the only one that struggles with the idea, and I invite you to join me in the spring. I start mine in February and March, where I start putting little posters that I make up and show a honeybee on a dandelion, and feed the bees. Don't poison your yards. I'm glad you did that question. Question number six. The next one comes from Kathy Montgomery. Have you ever purchased packaged bees from BeeWeaver or just queens? And for those of you who are not in the United States, the BeeWeaver family lives in Texas, and they raise survivor line, hygienic, varroa resistant bees. So they're in demand. The problem comes in that a lot of these packaged bees can't be shipped across the country. So they don't ship coast to coast. You have to be very local to get packaged bees from them. Otherwise, you know, they're concerned about the bees dying in shipment. What they do ship coast to coast are the queens themselves. So you can go to BeeWeaver and you can look at their queen selection and you can order a queen. I think this year they are $51, including shipping. And they come priority mail. So you get them within a day or two. So now if you don't have bees, if you're brand new and you've set up your beehive and you're ready for bees, you generally want to buy in packaged bees, or you want to get a nucleus of bees on comb with brood and everything going. And those all include queens. Then if you fly in a weaver queen, then you can't put her in one of those because they already have their queens. And since you can't buy a package, you can't buy the queen by herself unless you have a colony established. So how do you do it? You're going to have to wait until a colony that you get locally. So whatever source you have, right now you can get Saskatraz bees, let's say. So you can get those and they come in a package. So when you install your Saskatraz bees in a deep 8-frame or 10-frame Langstroth deep or a flow hive, then let them build up, and they build up fast in the spring. And when, instead of adding boxes to them, let them concentrate their resources and let them start to build swarm cells, and you'll see some queen cells in there. So that means they're ready to split. And that's when you take apart that beehive, you set another hive next to it, and split those resources into the two different boxes. And that's when you've called in your order for your queen. And within a couple of days of that split occurring, because you want them separate from the queen in this box for at least 3 days, and then you install the queen from the weaver family, and now you will have weaver bees. What happens to the queen cells that they have with them? Once a fertile queen shows up, 9 times out of 10, they'll chew open the cells and get rid of her themselves once they accept a new queen. Now, if you're absolutely positive that the queen that you've ordered in is going to work out, and if you get the little queen cage, they come in a queen cage like this, and the queen will be in here, and she'll have a couple of workers with her, and then there's a sugar plug that goes in it too. So the way it works is the bees in the colony chew through the sugar plug, but what you'll notice is their behavior on the surface of this. And if they're sticking their tongues out and they're feeding that queen and they're accepting of her, then you already know that they're going to accept her there. If it were a colony that had a queen and she's viable and she's laying, they're going to actually double their abdomens over and actually try to sting through here, or they'll ignore it completely and not feed them. So if they're feeding her, that's the right colony, and that's where you're going to release your BeeWeaver queen into that colony. And I've demonstrated that in several videos. So how to introduce a queen, how to find out if your colony needs a queen. And so that's how you do it. If all you can buy in is a queen, then split one of the colonies you already have. And that's something that every brand new beekeeper needs to know how to do. And then when you do that, you need to provide lots of resources for them so they're comfortable and they want to stay there. And once you install a new queen, or once you have a new colony, leave them alone. don't open it up because you're so anxious to see what's in there, you can actually drive them back into swarm mode and lose your bees. So once you install them, once she's accepted, once the queen is out of her cage, get the queen cage out of there, close it up, put 50-50 sugar water on there, and let them arrange things for themselves, let them settle, and then you just watch that landing board. And when you start seeing the pollen coming in, that's going to be great. So to answer the question, ever purchased packaged bees from BeeWeaver? No, can't because I live too far away. And just queens, yes, that's all I buy from them. And it's a great way to do it, by the way. Watch my videos this coming spring because I have some packages coming in. And guess what I'm going to do? As soon as a package gets here, and they're Saskatraz bees, we have 15 colonies in the yard right now. And the Saskatraz bees come in what's called a bee bus. These things are cool. All the packing information comes on top. It's reusable. You can take it apart and dump the bees in. It comes with its own little feed tin. When this thing comes, guess what I'm going to do? And I encourage, you know, more experienced beekeepers out there that are watching right now. I am not convinced that packaged bees don't show up with varroa already on those workers. So I'm going to pull the queen out of that package when it comes. And then I'm going to do oxalic acid vaporization on the package. And I'm going to see if they're carrying varroa. And I'm going to share that information with you. A lot of these bees are showing up preloaded. And Jake saying he needs Russian queens. I know you do, Jake. So, here's the thing. It is very easy to buy in queens when you already have bees. So the real puzzle and the real frustration is for the people that are just starting out with bees and they want to pick the bees they want and they want to fly in a package. So now you could always go and you could drive all the way there and get them. Here's what some bee clubs do, what some beekeeping groups do. Is they'll appoint one person to go and they'll order 50, 60 packages of bees, 100 packages of bees, and they'll send one person with a truck to go and purchase packages of bees, and they go to the site, they pick them up, and they drive them all the way back, and they drive straight through. So they don't stop at motels and take a chance that their truck sits in the sun and overheats and all that. And the truck needs to be very well ventilated. And you need to have sugar water to spritz your bees while you're on your trip so that they can get other resources other than what's in that little can. So that's the other route. Get a bunch of like-minded people who want the same type of bee. Send a representative down. Make sure you have your paperwork for the Department of Agriculture. And bring those bees back with you. Next one comes from somebody named Mapnr, M-A-P-N-R. And this question was just asked this morning. It says, let me ask you, do you use the herb essential oils to destroy the varroa? And this is something that there actually was scientific testing done on essential oils and their impact on varroa destructor mites. The varroa destructor mites, if you don't know, attack your bees. They reproduce in your in the cells where the bees are pupating. And then when the pupa hatch out, they have varroa mites on them. And so a lot of early studies were done. I'm just going to show, because what's an essential oil? A lot of companies are selling them. The big ones, and people primarily use this as an additive for your sugar syrups in spring. And you want to give this when there's not going to be honey supers on that you plan to take off. So Honeybee Healthy is one of the more recognized ones. There's also Pro Health, which is from Man Lake. And there is also Honeybee Feeding Stimulant. And if you, any of you want to look it up, I've done lots of testing on these and shown honeybee preferences. And one thing we know for sure is that adding essential oils to your sugar syrup will keep bacteria from growing in the sugar syrup. Now, it's the essential oils' ability to defeat bacteria. Also, there's a strong odor that comes with it too. So there was a study, several studies, in fact, that were done to see if they could increase the amount of essential oils in the hive and if it would actually kill off the varroa. But what happened was, in most of the published studies, by the time they got the concentrations high enough, normally you're giving 1 teaspoon per quart or 2 teaspoons per quart of sugar water with the Honeybee Healthy, Pro Health, and so on. But at higher concentrations, it did have some impact on the varroa mites. But the problem was, at those high concentrations, it also was defeating so much of the beneficial bacteria that was inside the colony that it actually was not considered a viable means for dealing with the varroa destructor mite. So that testing has been done, those papers have been published, and they go way back, many years. So it's something that people really hoped would work. It did not work as well as other more widely accepted methods for treating varroa. And of course, my money overall is on developing bee lines that are naturally hygienic and varroa resistant on their own. So those of you who are looking at this, I encourage you, even though we're backyard beekeepers and we should be monitoring for mite loads and we should be treating when necessary for mite loads with whatever, you know, method you in your own reasoning decide is going to work the best for your bees. For me, it's oxalic acid vaporization, and that's because of the Saskatrass bees that I keep. But in the meantime, while we're taking care of our bees, support those breeders that are coming out with the best lines of naturally resistant bees. And that's how we can do something for the varroa destructor as far as defeating them with genetics, lines of bees that do it on their own, because that is the long-term sustainable route, in my opinion. And but Pro Health, Honeybee Healthy, all the stuff, the feed stimulants, I don't think they're necessary. Only if you're trying to keep your syrups, you know, when you put the 50-50 sugar water on in the spring to feed your bees, or you're feeding a new, you know, swarm or something that you've hived, then adding a teaspoon of that is going to extend the life of the syrup. But the other thing is, if those bees are consuming the syrup quick enough, it really won't matter. The other thing is, you can get the same result by adding some bleach to your sugar syrup as well. Again, 1 teaspoon per quart. That's like giving them swimming pool water. So essential oils are, I hate to say it, but they're not essential to the honeybees. But lots of testing has been done. They're good to go. Okay. And what else are we going to do? That was the last question. So how long have we been talking? 27 minutes, that's pretty fast. So the other thing is, now we're open to a live chat. So those of you who tune in and just wanted to see the pre-established questions because you don't like the interaction when it comes to live chatting, that was the end of that. So tune back in Sunday afternoon. We're going to do another live chat. And that one will be a planned live chat. Today was supposed to be my regular question and answer video, but I decided to go live. And I hope the quality held up. So now here we go. Now I'm going to start to look at the questions over here, which are over here on your screen, over here on mine. And we'll see if anybody's got something that they wanted to know. Perhaps, well, apiary, if you want to give advice, go to an expert mate. Okay, what are we talking about now? Kismet has, check out Vino Farm on YouTube. He has hives of Russians, and they can be a bit aggressive. Let me go all the way back to the beginning. There better not be arguments in here. Any arguments, you guys are going to go away. So hello to everyone that's here for the live chat now. And hello, receive notification. Happy to catch you live. Thank you. Good to be here. Will bees use honey left over from this winter later, either in a dearth or next winter? So that comes from CMT. And I learned that I can push the Alt button and freeze this comment section. So what happens is, those of you who have left a lot of honey on your bee colonies going into winter, that's a good reserve for your bees. Sometimes it will solidify in the honey frames, and that means you can't take it out with a normal extraction. So what I do is, once spring hits and that nectar flow is coming in, and the bees are starting to fill up on their own, guess what they do? They no longer use their old stored honey, which is why honeybees are a fantastic resource for people to begin with. They make and save way more than they will use. So in the spring, that's when you take off the oldest honey frames. You go through your boxes, pull out the old frames. They're bringing in new ones, replace the frames right away. And then I store them. And then when there's a dearth, just like's being said here, I take those frames out of capped honey and I put them at a robbing station. And I give the foragers something to do because it also helps to defeat robbing. And you're giving them straight honey back. Honey is the greatest return on their physical investment that they can run across as foragers because it's ready to go. They load up on honey, they come back, it goes straight into the cells from the storekeeper bees, so they still pass it on to each other. And then the storekeeper bee puts it in the cell and doesn't need to be dehydrated anymore, it's ready to go. So it's a great resource for them, and it's a great way to recycle solidified honey. So that's good. And so the quality. Yeah, thanks, Steve. People are commenting about, I hope the quality is really good because you know what? For some reason today, I just decided to take a chance and do a live feed. How soon should I treat or check for mites after receiving a new package of bees, brand new beekeeper? This is from Christopher Hall. Do it within the first week. And you can do a mite check, but you can also, again, I'm going to be doing this year. I'm going to demonstrate how to check for mites. I ran out of time last year. And we're also going to treat a package of bees. We're going to see if the mites are on them. So within the first week, you want to get to treating for mites before they start to have capped brood. So that's the limit. The rest of the time, they're all open. Efficacy is going to be really good. And it's going to be very effective. Good morning, Pilot McBride. Hello, JP the Bee Man. Greetings from Kingston. Hello, Steve Schinnerer. I had a great first year and having a great winter so far. What is your timetable of activities that you do during winter into the spring to begin preparing for the new season? Well, my preps for the new season are pretty much done already. So what I do during winter is prepare boxes and equipment for the spring. So the other thing is we have to make sure to monitor your top feeder shims. Hopefully all of you have feeder shims on your bee boxes that are on the top with a barrier between the feeder and the lower boxes so that you're not exposing them and you can get in there to check resources. Today it's 47 degrees where I live and it's raining. If it hits 50, I find that the bees break cluster and start moving around inside. That's a good time to check your resources again on top. Don't be curious and dig down into your hives. Don't break the seals between the boxes. That's why the feeder shim is there so we can access the feed inside the feeder shim without disrupting any of the propolis and wax seals that they've got going on in there. The season's not over. So my preparations are just to rework the hive equipment, have it all staged. If anything needs to be painted, this is the time of year to do it. And of course, getting stuff ready to go for spring. So when the nectar flow kicks in, now we took out boxes in the fall, we start adding them again. I'm also going to be talking about cleaning equipment coming up. Have a method that you're going to want to see. So within the next couple of weeks, we're going to go over that. So that's it. That's what I do in preparation. Those of you who are looking for other things to prepare for, just like with baby chickens, people should be ordering the bees they want now for spring because they may sell out. So that's what I do. Happy New Year, Fred. Great. Once again, make yourself available. Glad to be here too. Mac, thank you so much. Do you think a 5-frame nuke is a good starter for a newbie? Here's the thing. This is from Lenny Long. I don't use nukes at all. You'll never see them in my bee yard. And that the reason is the smallest box I'll put in is an 8-frame brood box. And that's because what is the purpose of a nucleus hive? Usually that's to sell bees or when you're buying bees as a nuke. Nuke is short for nucleus. Anyway, that contains frames, capped brood, some resources. Usually it's up to 5 frames. And I put those straight into an 8-frame box if that's what I'm going to use, or I put them in a 10-frame box if that's what I'm going to use. I don't do those intermediate stages of smaller boxes and scaling it up. I put them straight into the brood box that they're going to stay in. I always have. Even 12, 13 years ago when I went out and bought nucleus bees from another breeder, I brought my own 8-frame box and I just had them put all the frames directly in it right there. Took them back to my bee yard. So I don't do those intermediate stages. So the good starter is straight into a single deep, 10 or 8 frame, whatever you're going to have. Put the nucleus frames right in the middle, and then your empty frames outlying from that, and let them go to work and let them fill them up. So here you go, JP the Bee Man. 10 people with 20 different answers. Okay. Well, I try to give, you know, one answer. And let's see what's going on. Because we have Leon Long. Yes, Nuke would be the best. Yeah, Nuke is your fastest startup. But again, I just suggest that you put it straight into a full-size deep box, 10 or 8. Ricky Westgate, thanks, Fred. I am in Australia, and as you are aware, we're in a bushfire crisis. What should I do as a countermeasure to protect the hive from the large amount of smoke around? Ricky, that's a big deal. And for those of you who don't know, the fires that were subsiding have actually not subsided and are really kicking in. And some people were circulating pictures of bee yards that were completely burned out. So unfortunately, and by the way, I have a background in firefighting. I used to be a fire marshal, big surprise, Navy. And so what can you do about the smoke around the hives? There really isn't anything except let the bees ventilate it off themselves. You are smoking your bees yourselves generally. The thing is, the quality of the air everywhere is going down. I'm much more concerned about the heat than the smoke. And there really isn't a lot that you can do about it. The bees are going to fan that out on their own. And I hope you keep us posted regarding how that goes. Because some whole bee yards are just being burned out there. I still don't know what's going on with the Flow Hive people. They're in New South Wales. New South Wales has huge areas of out of control fires. So, and even one of the firefighting response teams got involved in a blowover. And so they sat in place and locked down and put shields up against their windows and everything, and the truck blew over. So the wind is extreme. I can't even imagine what's going on there. Here's Kismiaz, or better, two of them as two hives gives you a better chance. Always, always. I would say the minimum number of hives for a backyard beekeeper is two. You always want two. You don't want to have a total loss one year and then just be out of the honey business. Thank you for your valuable information, which has helped me to expand to 9 hives down here in sunny Florida. Well, I'm glad to have helped you. This is Odenwald. And then Leon, thanks. Don't cut my yard for the first month of the year. Yeah, I have no mow November. So yeah, for those of you that who can avoid mowing your yards, at least you can mow it, but you know, let it cut above the flowers there. Hello, Fred. Happy to see you today. Video quality is great. Salah. Thank you. It's good to see you here. Here's Ray down to minus 39. That's the day high. Now that's minus 39. We have been really lucky. I don't know if it's luck, though. My bees tend to do extremely well on the really cold winters that stay cold and we don't have breaks. We're getting these weird rainy breaks. Those historically have proven not to help the bees, because if they warm up before resources are out there, then they're just consuming their own resources. Plus, there's this dynamic that goes on inside the hive. Really cold nights, really warm days. What do we get? Condensation, moisture. And so we get a high humidity environment. And so that's, you know, it's going to be interesting in the spring to see whose bees did what and how it went. Here's Ethne says, dandelions don't compete with the grass either. The roots go much deeper and are beneficial by bringing nutrients up from deeper soil. I'm a dandelion fan. So there we go. Have you used diatomaceous earth around the ground below the hives to control unfriendly insects? I did it one time to get rid of a ant colony. Outside of that, I just don't use it. So the other thing is that all my beehives now are up on iron T-posts. It's very easy to control. We can climb up the T-posts and can't. So I really have zero problem. But diatomaceous earth, you want to make sure to keep that stuff away from your bees. And of course, after it rains, it's defeated by the rain. So you'd have to replenish it and stuff. But you also say control unfriendly insects. It would depend on what those are. Remember, strong colonies really do hold their own pretty well. even when ants, you know, again, I'm not in the south, I'm in the north, so I don't have big ant problems either. Now somebody else just wrote, 1952 toots. I just learned that earthworms are not native everywhere in the USA. That's correct. They were brought in. In fact, you need to, there's a really good book. Get your pen ready. It's called The Earth Moved. And you can read about earthworms. And let me tell you, it's as much about horticulture as anything else. And it is fantastic. But yeah, the earthworm, as beneficial as it is not native. My chickens spend every morning eating earthworms. Perhaps Royal Apiary, Fred, you know you are my friend, but your argument about the companies that sell the grass treatment is like you arguing the Flow Hive, considering you affiliated with the company. Sorry, LOL. This is from Pabst Royal Apiary. My argument about the companies that sell the grass treatment. So my argument about the companies is, when they come and treat your lawn and they lie to you and tell you that it is not harmful to anyone, yet they have to put signs out that say, keep off pets and children. And it's a pesticide and an herbicide, depending on which mix you decide to get. So I'm not arguing. I'm just sharing information, and I'm pointing out that we don't need to get rid of the weeds that the companies are telling you that you need to get rid of. Now let's go, is like you arguing, perhaps Royal Apiary, I'm surprised you're calling me out, but that's okay. It's like you arguing the Flow Hive, considering you affiliated with the company. Sorry, LOL. Okay, Pat. When I first bought the Flow Hive, I invested in their Indiegogo campaign. I don't know those people. My very first Flow Hive that came out, I did a review that was not favorable, primarily because of the woodenware that came, the quality, and that video is still out there. And then I decided to test the Flow Hive on my own. And which is rare, because a lot of people that I knew and a lot of people that I respected came right out and said it was garbage, a toy, junk, it won't work. They said everything from the way bees behave to the way that the honey moves out, that they won't put, that you can't tell if it's full of honey, that it's going to be wet honey, that people are going to harvest bees, that people are going to be irresponsible. So, and then he says, and you affiliated with the company. Sorry, LOL, I'm not sorry. Eventually, the Flow Hive company started to look at my videos. They liked what they saw, and they sent me messages saying how happy they were that I liked the Flow Hive. And I also put out the links. They invited me to put links up, which would give me $50 off my future Flow Hive purchases, in exchange for giving whoever bought through those links $50 as well. So if that's what you mean by affiliated, I definitely am. I don't work for Flow Hive. The other thing is that's come out this year is thebeekeeper.org, again, from the Flow Hive people. They invited me to teach some lessons, okay, on the Flow Hive. And so I am in that thebeekeeper.org educational website as a presenter, and the Flow Hive people invited me to give presentations and talk about some of their flow equipment. Why wouldn't they? Being that I have personal experience with it, being that I have had a successful experience with it, if you had that company, wouldn't you reach out to people like me and ask them to share about what was good or bad about it? And I've done both. So the other thing is affiliation, according to Pabst Royal Apiary. My affiliation with them, am I being paid by Flow Hive? Zero. Wait, let me tell you how much they paid me to give a lesson on their beekeeper.org website. Zero. Guess what I asked for? Nothing. Why? Because I'm interested in sharing about bees. I want to teach people about bees. My first bee video was in 2008. So, Pabst Royal Apiary, I am not arguing. I'm sharing my experience. If you hate it or disagree or don't like it, that's fine. But don't call me out and say that I'm affiliated with the company. I'm not employed by the company. I don't get benefits from the company. They sent me a Flow Hive, to review, and that was free. But the other flow hives in my apiary I obtained. So if you're going to call somebody out, you don't have to be sorry, LOL, but you do have to be accurate. So thank you for that and giving me a chance to respond to that right here, live. Thinless, my granddaughters love picking the dandelion flowers. Who doesn't? Here's Pap again. I like the Flow Hive, but I wouldn't ask for advice on that from anyone affiliated with Flow Hive Company. I would go to somebody that could be fair on their assessment. Either is good or bad. So Pap's Royal Apiary, again, I've explained myself. If you've got proof, bring it, because what you're putting out here is defamation. You're saying that I'm misrepresenting how I'm putting information out there. I don't generally like arguments, but I'm not going to walk away from what I do, which is fair evaluations of honeybee equipment across the board, not just Flow Hive. It just happens that a lot of people ask me about that. So there again, thank you so much for your concerns. I am not in their pocket. Kizmias, video quality just dropped. Dang. Let's keep going. Check out Vino Farm on YouTube. He has a hive of Russians. He can't. Yeah, he does. Kiss my ass. Definitely check out Vino Farm. I'm sorry, we always say Vino Farm. Vino Farm. That guy's building a major barn right now. Oh, dear. Pap's Royal Apiary. If you want advice, go to an expert, mate. Not a spurt. Okay, video and audio. Fine here. Here, what else do we have? What else are we doing here? I feel like you're an honest man, Fred. All your videos are like documentaries and you're very objective. Thanks for all the good you do. Thank you, Thinless, for recognizing that I am neutral in my appraisals of everything. I received my Flow 2 Cedar Hive and I'm looking forward to using them as soon as possible. Good, I hope you have a great time. And I think we're going to wrap up the live chat today. So if you're interested in any of the designs and stuff that I've done for shirts and cups, those are in the Teespring lineup down below. And that's pretty much it. Coming up Sunday, we might do another live chat. And we'll see how it goes from there. So thanks for joining me today. I hope you're having a great weekend. And I hope your bees are getting through winter really well. And if you're in Australia, our thoughts are with you, and I hope that the fires do not overwhelm wherever it is that you reside and that the weather turns in your favor very soon. Thank you so much for being here today.